dance. Now I get my hair in a rope like this. It's raining.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's the only reason you're writing. I hear them sung back at you. I want to send out the best of the folks at Double Take that are here tonight. I want to thank all you guys coming down. Send this out to Bob Coles, my good friend Bob Coles. I love about work, play, family, place, love, sex, political and social forces that play on our lives. Those are things that I was interested in and getting into my music. And I want people to come to my shows and see themselves and feel themselves and also see part of the world around them that they might not see all the time. That was part of the artist's job. And I always felt that my job was to answer the questions that my work threw up. And I kept chasing those questions. And that was how I knew that I was alive. You know, because I always wanted to continue to know. I'm going to do this tonight for Bob, because Bob is expert question asker. The man that gave Gilt its good name back. and somebody had to do it. But I guess it was a while ago, Bob sent me a book, Secular Mind, a little something he dashed off in his spare time. And he wrote me a nice note with it. And I was reading it at the beginning of the introduction of the book. He was talking about a 70s interview that he did with Dorothy Day, and she was talking about the idea of a secular mind, that there's a moment where during everybody's day where things stop, and you leave that secular mind, which is sort of the tasks that take up your day, and for a moment you're connected to other things, larger things. Sometimes it can be there's certain things that automatically do it: birth of a child, death of somebody that you love, listening to Louie Louie. These are the things that automatically transport you into some place larger, you know. And I guess that idea is sort of what songs and music and art are for, you know. It facilitates that purpose, taking you outside of that's your secular self and moving you into a place where your spirit, hopefully, along with your ass, can be nurtured. So that's kind of how I've taken my job over the years. And I'm going to take us back now to a record I started with, Darkness on the Edge of Town. Because to me, that was my borderland, darkness. That was where all things are in flux and up for grabs, where time is running late. And there's always work to be done. That was the turf I staked out on that record, and I still go back to it many, 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 time and time again. So this one for Bob especially. Moment into my knees. get up every morning, go to work each day. Your eyes go blind and your blood runs cold. Sometimes I feel so weak I just want to explode. Explode and tear this old town apart. Take a knife and cut this pain from my heart. Try to find somebody can for something to start. Well, dogs on Main Street howl as they understand. I could take this moment into my hand. Mr. Halloween, I thought no harm would be. I believe promised
thank you.
trying something I haven't done before, and with the exception of tomorrow night, we'll never do again. But I'm serious. All right. There's going to be a gentleman with a microphone, and if you have any questions about how I do my job, I'll be glad to try and answer them for you. The only two questions I don't answer are what comes first, the music or the lyrics? And how do I get my hair looking like it? Generally, give me a regular six string, I guess. I'm gonna sit with that thing. So, anybody want to take a shot?
Yeah, right here.
All right. Here you go. What about writer's block? I don't really. I'm trying to think. I haven't had it in a while. I've been writing pretty freely in the past, but I've had it in the past. Born in the USA, it was ugly. Now I was sitting there. I had Born in the USA. And I had my hometown. I said, man, those are great. Man, those are just good. Them songs, you know. And I think I had Glory Days and a bunch of other ones, but I just couldn't get any more. And I'd done Nebraska, and I felt Nebraska was some of my best writing. So I wanted to make a rock record that sort of took from there and went forward, and I just felt like I couldn't do it. And I worked so hard, I hacked stuff out like crazy. I had no life at the time, so that helped. Or maybe that probably hindered, you know. I had no life. That was when I started to notice it, you know. When I was about 34, and I said, gee, if I'm not writing, I'm sucking a big one down. Because, man, I got no life, so I got nothing else to do, you know. So that was really, that maybe that had something to do with it. That was probably the last time when it was put on. I think that when I wasn't actually writing, I felt like, you know, it was time to you know, leave the planet, because I just couldn't do it. I wasn't doing anything else. And but that was, I don't know, you know, you just keep rolling, and they come up, eventually something comes around, and sometimes it, you know, in the end may feel a little forced to you, and sometimes you just gotta quit and get out there. And I have other opinions around me that help, you know. And on that record, they were very helpful. Steve was very helpful. John was very helpful. They said, well, you know, this stuff that we had was pretty good. We cut half of the record, I think, before I cut Nebraska. And we ended up going back to a lot of that stuff. Arlington County, Out on Fire. Half of the Glory Days, Born in the USA. Most of those songs were all cut before Nebraska, and they ended up being stuff we ended up going back and putting back on. So, you know. But I don't have any way of, I don't have any secret of, you know, of dealing with it. I just kind of sit. And sometimes, you know, you just gotta wait. It's gonna happen. So, all right.
Bruce.
All right,
excuse me.
I hear somebody. Go ahead.
Yes, I got the microphone.
Power to you, brother.
You're one of my heroes and one of millions of people's heroes in America.
Thank you very much.
I just heard today that for the upcoming CBS special, that you have a corporate sponsor, I think, for the first time.
Well, I don't have a corporate sponsor, you know. I mean, they show commercials on television as they play them on the radio, you know. So I believe there's a couple of breaks for commercials, but they're not sponsoring me.
I misunderstood, but what I'd like to ask you is,
I wouldn't have waited so long if I was going to go that way. Hey, back in 1985, if I was going to be. I'd have been selling some Oreos, man. Blue jeans, man. Plenty of all. So, no, it's just TV commercials. I don't know. I guess the ones I played tonight I like a lot, you know. But, you know, I guess Darkness was always one of my favorites. I still
Bruce?
Interesting that a lot. Yes.
Bruce, is it
like my conscience? This is.
There's a new book out called Bruce Springsteen and Bob Dylan, The American Song. Could you comment on that? And what kind of influence has he had on you?
Well, the book, I don't know. Somebody actually did send me a copy of it, so I kind of liked it because my picture was on the front of the box. So that's what it, you know. But I don't know much more about the book besides that. And the fellow did send me a copy, but I tend to not read about myself due to the fact that living with myself is enough. You know? But unless somebody says, man, this is really great, you should read it. But, Bob, what can I say? You know, he was the guy that really put a lot of things together that a lot of us guys afterwards follow. Also, he's carried on as an artist, you know, as he's gotten older. You know, I mean, he's made some terrific records as of late. The last record I thought was great, and I loved the one before that. So, you know, he's just continually creative, and that's inspirational, I think. You know, so I always got, you know, he was always like the fountain for me. You know, I still get a lot of inspiration out of throwing his stuff on. And just amazed at the breadth of his work and the stuff he's done. So,
Bruce. Yeah. Bruce, thank you. Sorry about that.
Okay. Just freaking me out.
Don't mean to freak out.
All right, go ahead.
Just curious, how fresh was the hurt when you wrote back in your arms?
I just wrote like a soul song. The hurt wasn't very fresh. it was just something that I think I wrote it. I wrote it for the record after Lucky Town, which I didn't put out. I have it sitting around. It was written for that record, which was kind of another record about relationships. And it ended up when we were looking for a song for the Gracie's record, put it on. It was nice, it had that four top. In my dream, my love was lost. So just everything. And if I love you, baby, I carried you inside of me. Prayed it wouldn't be too late. Now I'm standing on this empty road where nothing moves but the wind. And darling, something, back in your arms. So it was like, it was kind of a soul exercise for me. You know, I like to sing like that. I do as best as I can with it. But it didn't come out of any place, you know, particularly hurtful. At least not immediately. They got this girl. I don't think I can use
that.
Who was inspiring Spanish Johnny? I don't know. I was in New York a lot at the time, and it was really. I think I was simply in the city a lot in those early days. I went up because they were paying me money to play at Max's Kansas City, and. I was just in the city a lot, and I kind of was enjoyed writing about New York a little bit more on my first few records. There's quite a bit of New York music via the New Jersey sensibility, you know. and so it was just something. I think that song always came down to, good night, it's all that changed. Meet me tomorrow night. You may find it was all about that. That chorus came around, and it was just melodically a nice piece of music, and we made a nice record.
Bruce?
Yeah.
Yeah, hey. My name is Doug, and I just want to...
That's terrific. That was my father's name.
And my brother's name is Bruce.
Woo!
Number one, I wanted to say that I think you're maybe among the most underappreciated lead guitar players there.
Yeah, I play pretty well. Thank you. That used to be my thing. You know, I started out as a guitar player. They wouldn't let me sing in my first band. They used to tease me terribly about my voice. So I started out playing lead guitar. And in my area, until I was well into my 20s, that was kind of my rep. You know, I was the guitar slinger in central New Jersey. As a matter of fact, when my first record came out and it had no electric guitar on it, people were really pissed off. You know? I remember going, hey, man, what happened? What happened? Where's the guitar? That's your thing, you know? And I didn't have an answer. But at the time, I was lucky that I got the band on. They wanted me to make an acoustic record, which probably would have been a good idea. But we kind of compromised, and I was acoustic guitar with rhythm section. And but thank you. I'm glad you enjoyed my riffing.
I also want to ask you, I noticed you're not using the Esquire Telly as much as you have been before. And also, I think I gave this to you upstairs. I think you dropped it. I was wondering if I could give this to you again. This is really important to me. It's my CD.
From a great one.
Thank you very much.
But as far as, you're not going to sue me, are you? I'll be sued by this gentleman in the years to come. The guitar was just something where I've got a series of other guitars and a variety of different tunings, but I played it for 25 years, bought it for $185, and it's a piece of my body at this point when I put it on. It's not a guitar. All right, go ahead. So whoever's got the mic, give a shot. I'll get to you next.
Over here, Bruce.
Well, I can't see you, but I believe
Bruce.
Okay.
How do you pick your set list every night? And are there any songs that maybe you've kind of put away and said, I'm not going to play anymore?
There tends to be some, you know, that I'll go on tours where, on this particular tour, we're not playing this group of songs. Usually it's just to give them a rest, you know, or I try to balance between the old work and the new work, because when I put the band back together, the one thing I didn't really want to get into, I didn't want it to be sort of a nostalgia fest, you know. I think people come and you have a shared history with people that's very, very important and that I enjoy, and I want it to feel like that. You know, you've taken a long trip with somebody and you know somebody really well. But I want it to continue to be based very much in the present, and the band's done a great job of setting the air every night. So sometimes I will put away certain songs if I feel it's playing too much to the crowd on a given night or so, you know, and I'll go for something else. But the set list just comes up. Like this one, just kind of, you know, I only had a few days to put it together, and there's some things I like to play, but like Darkness on the Edge of Town, I just like to play it, you know, it feels central to me, so I wanted to make sure I didn't fuck up the first thing that I played. So I picked that one first, you know, because, well, I know how to play that one. Then Adam Raised Cain, that's in the same tuning, and so that worked, and then, you know, My Father's House, well, Adam Raised Cain, that's, you know, fathers and sons, and so I go, well, I'll take it in a little bit deeper. Stick the knife in a little bit deeper and go to My Father's House. Then I'll try something that's up because I want everybody to leave and kill themselves. So I go to you know, Bus Stop or Growing Up, and then Frio, because it's kind of funny, and I don't know, it's a fun song to perform. You know, Thunder Road, because Born to Run, I want to play something from Born to Run, because central record for me, and that song is real, real big. It still encompasses so much of my work that even when I play it, it's just big. It just takes in a lot. And Nebraska, because it sort of reached that was a record that I feel like I hit a different spot in my writing, and that particular song was central to that record, and central to a certain type of character that I learned to write well about, that really came from some place inside me that I felt very, very connected to. My family, a combination of Italians, that was my mother and her sisters, and they were all hysterical kind of joy freaks. No matter what happened, you know, they were always unbelievably optimistic, and their ability to communicate happiness continues to this day. I would come home from my aunt's house deaf from the screaming over nothing. Just the shrieking that went on. And then my dad was Irish, and that was the other thing, you know, that was you know, the police coming to the house parties and that sort of thing. So I tried to cover them both a little bit. And so that was Nebraska River, because it was central. So I'm beginning to write narratively, USA, because of what it's about, and souls and the wall, they were all connected to just the theme of war and surviving. And Bobby Jean, friendship, hometown, sense of place, brilliant disguise, the only thing, little things fall behind. That was just, you know, men and women and sex and love and ghosts, because that was where I turned back outside again and started to write more about what I was singing and returned to kind of a narrative voice. So the Rising is new and takes that theme of resurrection once again, brings it up. Promised Land, because I like to play it, you know, it's a good song for Bob. So that's a brief. So just it kind of one thing leads to the next, you know, just follow it down. All right,
moving.
Yeah.
Talking about that, and then Paradise.
Paradise. I haven't played that one because it's hard to play live. I could play it down, but it's hard to play in a big place because it needs so much stillness, you know, because it's one of those songs. Racing in the Street was based on a kid I knew in Asbury Park, who I used to see down in the bar all the time, you know, and so it was sort of, the theme of the thing was set, it was just this young kid that I knew with the car, and it started with him, and then it always ends up with you somehow, you know, it always ends up. I wanted to write about the classic rock images, cars, and things that I love, like Chuck Berry and the Beach Boys, but I wanted to fill them with sort of the dread that was a part of everybody's life post-Vietnam, you know, and that was, once again, the redemption. The whole thing about that song leads up to the instrumental. The instrumental at the end of that record tells the rest of the story. One of my favorite songs, I like that one a lot, you know. What's the promise about it? I don't know, you know. It must have been about sex. You know? I can't say, you know. I guess it was about, that was sort of, after Born to Run, I wrote that for Darkness, I think. And I was reflecting on sort of the flip side of Thunder Road, I think. I was reflecting on the responsibilities and that I thought came with my fortune at that time and how it sort of fit into my life. And that's generally what I remember it being about in some fashion. Okay.
I have a question.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Will I sign that? No, not right now. Go ahead. I'll sign it later, though. go ahead.
First of all, I want to say good luck at the Grammys. How does it feel having the best fans in the world?
Having the best fans in the world. Yeah. I got good fans. I give you credit because, you know, one night I ask you to scream your heads off, and next night I got everybody shuts up, everybody speaks up, kid. You know, so and people respond very well in both circumstances. I was very happy on the Tom Joe tour where I went out, and the show needed so much quiet, and to be able after, you know, so many years of playing hard and loud, to be able to get that from the audience as I did, only had to throw a few people out, you know, and as I generally got was very, very satisfying, and you know, it was nice. Well done, you know. Okay.
First, this is a great gift for Double Cake, so thank you.
Oh, my pleasure, yeah.
And I wanted to know, how did you come to the decision to be a fundraiser, and what else do you want to achieve in your life?
Well, you know, this was, I knew Bob, you know, and just an admirer of Bob and his work and his writing, and you know, I got the magazine very regularly. It was just a terrific magazine, very unusual, tremendous, just the photography and the amateur, you know, clicking away myself, it was just something that there's just nothing out there like it, and so, and I like Bob. I admire Bob's work tremendously. So it's a pleasure to be here tonight. Across the board, yes.
It was something almost like a whisper. Yeah. Something that I don't think you've ever done before. It's a little step of that hand. Is the character? Which side of the border is he on? As he crossed over the United States and he's walking back to his honey. Or has he had to come back to Mexico? That's a,
I didn't actually think about all that. Those are the kinds of questions the songwriter doesn't have to answer, you know, because the song's good, you know, but the song is sort of, how can I put it? it was, I guess it was religious in nature, in the sense that it was about going someplace where, you know, love exists and redemption exists, and a place where you can live and just feel good, and where you can have a chance at making something and building something for yourself. It was really about somebody seeking those things, you know, coming out of a world of hurt and seeking those things. I think that when you write those songs, ultimately you set them in a variety of different settings, and that's part of what the songs are about. But they would not ring true unless you knew exactly what you were singing about, unless you could feel that thing, and I don't want to go across that border. I want to find those things I haven't found and touch those things that I haven't got a hold of yet. You know, some place that you believe exists somewhere, somehow. You know, so it was really, it was both about the things that were going on along the border in California, and just about a belief in that journey, I suppose. I'll give you a little bit of it. You go to the top of this sucker. Yeah. Hey, whisper, I see. I have my baggage bag. Tomorrow I'll want this train. It'll lead me across the border. Tomorrow I'm another man. Sleep neath all the skies, somewhere across the border. We'll leave behind my day, pain and sadness we found here. We'll drink from the bravos and muddy water, till the sky goes gray and white. We'll meet on the other side, across the border. For you I'll build a house, high up on a grassy hill, somewhere across the border, where pain and memory have been still, across the border. Sweet blossoms fill the air, pastures of golden green, roll down into cool, clear waters, and in your arms, neath open skies, I'll kiss the sorrow from your eyes, lay across the border. Tonight we'll sing a song, I'll dream of you, my love, and tomorrow my heart will be strong. May the saints' blessings and grace carry me safely into your arms, they cross the border. For what I weep without hope in our hearts, that someday we'll drink from God's blessed waters, eat the fruit from the vine. I know love and fortune will be mine somewhere across the border. Ooh.
And you know, a lot of your songs and a lot of your characters, I think, wrestle with this question.
Oh, yeah.
What does it mean to be a man of the spirit?
I don't know. You know, I think it's something I've... I think there was so much confusion about it when I was young, you know. You're up in the 50s generation, you know, it was real rigid, the ideas, the very painful ideas about how that was defined. My dad suffered under it pretty intensely, you know, and he kind of, you know, you pass on your confusions. So I think it was something that I sought as a songwriter, you know, I sought to define. In the end, it's all identity, 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 you know. Who am I? What am I doing here? And all your writing, from the first note to the last, is sort of in pursuit of some of those answers. And so that was a question that I dealt with a lot and often in my music, you know, and with the intention of sorting it out for myself. And I also drew quite an audience of young men. When I started out, there was, you know, and there's still, you know, there's still a lot of, you know, I had, I'd seen, it, certainly initially I had an audience that was more guys than gals, which was not the original intention. Of the but whatever, you know. And I think it was because I wrestled with those questions a lot and hopefully help people sort through them a little better than they've been sorted through in the past. So.
Hi.
Okay. Okay.
Over here.
Am I warm? All right.
Well, first of all,
I got you.
I just want to say thank you so much for your music.
Thank you.
And second of all, I don't know if it's a rumor or if it's true, but are we going to see you at the Fleet Center in August?
I can't emphasize on these issues. I'm sure we'll get back up here in some fashion or not.
Come back here.
Hi. I was just going to ask you if Rosie could start coming out again.
Please. Yeah, I play that one once in a while. I kind of save it for special occasions.
Asbury Park.
Well, we played it in Asbury lately.
That's
right.
I did play it there.
I
play it in Philadelphia.
Nope.
But I popped that one out once in a while. But one of these days.
We really appreciate it.
Bruce.
Okay.
You know, over the years, we all, as fans, have been blessed by growing up with your music, a lot of us, and it's great to meet all the fans. And I was wondering if you, as a performer, ever wake up still awed by the impact you have, and if ever that's an overwhelming responsibility you feel you have to respond to. It's just, how do you feel as an artist, you know, knowing
that you wake up awed by myself quite often. But I mean, in the end, you know, it's music, and you're the air guitar player, you know. But yeah, I guess the powers came just because it's the power of the storyteller, which is central in society, and I happen to be lucky to come out along the time when people pay the big bucks for that kind of thing, and so it's. I look at it, it's like an ongoing discussion and dialogue, and at some point, you step in every relationship you have, you feel responsibility with, and I certainly feel one with my audience, and at the same time, you know, it's my job, and it's my work, and I don't try to get too crazy about it, you know, I got a lot of other things to do now, also. So, anybody else? We'll take a few more. What do I listen to today? Let me see. I do a lot of curiosity buying. You know, this year I liked it. There was a record called New Folk Underground by a guy named David Berwald, who's made a lot of good records, and that was probably one of my favorite records that I've. Heard in a while. There was a group called Phantom Planet, young pop rock band that I dug. I like them a lot. Flaming Lips, they had a couple of the songs on the last record. I listened to a lot of things, you know.
and I just kind of find my way through it. And, yeah, right there.
You ever take your kids to
home drive? Yeah, they come once in a while, but it's pretty boring for them. I mean, let's face it. Who really wants to see thousands of people applaud their parents? You don't want to see that if you're a kid. It's not like, oh, that's cool, you know. You don't want to see it, you know. So they come once in a while, and they run around and have a good time. But what kid really wants to see it? All right, you got to promise to see it.
After all these years down the Jersey Shore, can you explain your connection to the Freehold and Asbury Park and
It's what I'm stuck with, you know. It's sort of the place where the connection to my home there. Sort of is like it's what we're all stuck with, you know. It's those places, as far as some more than others. I mean, I may know a few people who literally left and never went back and never thought of it again, but I don't know many, you know. There's too many ghosts and too many bodies buried, and I think that. It's just. That whole sense of place, that whole idea about, I was very interested in where I came from, and I'm not exactly sure why. I think I went back many, many times with the intent of trying to make right things that went wrong, trying to recreate a place that had only marginally existed, you know, in real life, I suppose. And as I did that, I just kind of investigated it further and further and looked at it closer and closer, and it was something that I just couldn't get out of myself, the idea that I needed to make a home for myself somehow there, that was important to me. I couldn't exactly tell you why, but I know that it was, and I pursued it very intensely. And also it was, I kind of believed in playing the cards you were dealt. I was from New Jersey, and I wanted to write about the why would that be get a round of applause? I don't know. So it was just something that I felt connected to and I've pursued since, you know.
Bruce.
Yes?
I'm up here in the back.
Okay.
I'm here in the back. First off, thank you for tonight. This is something special.
Oh, my pleasure.
You write about people, but you write about politics, you write about people in social situations, and that's one of the things some of us love most about you. So I'd like to ask you a question about politics. It's sure. Not an easy question, but I think it's a question on a lot of people's minds right now. Bob McNamara, you know, admitted that he made a horrible mistake. And I wanted to ask you if you thought that Donald Rumsfeld, with his Bob McNamara haircut, is about to make a horrible mistake.
I was talking to a friend earlier. He's taken on a bit of a strange lovey and tinge for me the last few months. But, I think that I asked a lot about this for months, because, you know, over in New York, we asked a lot about it. I guess I've read an awful lot about it, and it's amazing how confused I can get about it on any given day, you know. But I got two sons, and I think, well, if my sons were on the front line, what would I want, you know? And I said, well, you know, those wars that you get thrust into, I felt that's what happened in Afghanistan. There seems to be wars of choice, and that, for one reason or another, that seems to be, the administration seems very determined to have this war, you know. Personally, you know, I'm not a diplomat, I'm not a policymaker, but I think diplomacy can, you know, and also some, I think if my son was on the front lines, I would just, I want a policy of containment in some fashion. And that's really, that's in the end, that's the only place I've been able to kind of come down with it. I think when an artist, you value, because the individual is so important in your work, because that's the secrets you're chasing, and what is, you know, what is that, what's the essence of life, of living, you know, what, and that, I think if, you know, what if my kids were out there, you know, I wouldn't want to be sending them into battle in this particular war at this particular time, you know. Anybody else?
Right. I was wondering if you could comment on some of the reaction you've gotten to that in writing Horizon. Did you feel an obligation to tell the story? How did Horizon get done?
I started the telethon and they asked me to be on it and I was going to sing. So I wanted to write a song for it because I didn't know if I had one that felt right. And I wrote Enter the Fire, you know. I didn't get it finished and I didn't sing it, you know. But, No, I don't think I ever sit at a particular moment feeling I've got to write this kind of song or that kind of song, you know, or I don't really write from the outside in, you know, it's not an external, the spark is generally, it doesn't really come from that way. I mean, you're affected by what goes on in the world. But ultimately, you've got to suss it out internally, you know, what it means for you. And, like, all of those songs on those records had to stand on their own and they had to work independent of events. It's where the songs get their own integrity from. You could put The Rising, you could put it on Darkness on the Edge of Town. You could put Promised Land on The Rising. And, in some ways, but it could be about many, many different things, you know. The sky was falling and streaked with blood. Heard you calling me, then you disappeared into the dust. Up the stairs, into the fire. I need your kiss, but love and duty called you someplace high. Somewhere up the stairs, into the fire. I think when I wrote it, you know, may your strength give us strength. May your faith give us faith. It was just about spiritual feelings of community, sort of. Once again, it was kind of primarily, I write a lot of things that sort of have a religious foundation, and for me that was... It worked in that fashion also, besides being specific. A couple more and I'm going home, folks.
I have the microphone back here.
Good for you.
Go ahead.
In the middle.
I'm living in the greater Boston area, but I'm an Rebbe Catholic girl who grew up in that area and was fortunate enough to see you at places like Big Bands West and
sure.
Carlton Theater. And I wonder if you ever wish that you could go back for a moment and play those small clubs without all the...
Well, I can, you know. The idea that you can't do things that you once did is completely untrue. And, it's truly... There are certain things, you know, there are certain places and things that the mall on Saturday night, but actually, truth even there. The bottom line is, it's a lot of it has to do with just how you carry yourself and your own ideas about what you want to do. And so I play locally in the clubs somewhat regularly. You know, actually, you know, I play with some friends of mine. I still get a kick out of it. There's very little you can, you know, you're not really restricted in that fashion. At all. I got an F on Mark.
Bruce?
Yeah.
Hi. A question for you.
Later on.
when you do a live performance and you create the set list and in the middle of the set you give it audible to the band, is that something that you try to fit in thematically or is it just something that comes to you that you feel like playing?
Maybe things are going a little slow. I want to shake the band up. I want to shake the audience up. I want to shake myself up. Just got an idea, feel like playing something. The ability of the band to respond to those things is something we've worked on a lot over the years. Adds a lot of excitement to the show. You get out there, you know, you don't know, you know, it's like the best plan doesn't survive the first contact with the audience, you know. It's it just depends on a given night, you know. It's a certain sort of, keeps it spontaneous, keeps the guys from thinking they know too much about what's going to go on. So. But anyway, I'm going to play one more thing for you, which I guess this is one of my favorite songs too. And like I was saying, so I always try to answer the questions when I work through was in those questions that I really felt. I feel like it kept me alive. So, any more questions?
Thank you.
was a hairdresser, and his wife was a hairdresser. And the Upstate was a club where all those guys in the band met. And so they had this club on the weekends, and they did hair on the weekends. And when the place finally went bust, you know, they left town, and the hair salon went out of business, and I got left with the apartment, which was good. That's the scene. But so anyway, I wrote most of the songs for Greens from Asbury Park in this beauty salon. The back of it had an upright piano, and this song was one of the later ones I wrote. I handed the record in, and Clive Davis sent it back, and he said, "There's no hits." I'm gonna play the radio. Calm down here. And he was right.
Well, I jumped up, turned, I stood in the air, fell on the ground. I rock. Where mountains and bars shoot stones back in the sidecar. I'm a little joke. Yeah, guitar said, blow the bar, but first you need to quit the job. We'll teach those who are the lad to show. Rick Sun kidnapped Eddie Campbell's plane, and he caught the clap. Roots on my house, driving for last night. Well, I was sadly stroke at between his ears, I saw a gap. I figured he'd be alright.
Kid, full costume dress. But
My feet, they finally took root in the earth. Got me a nice little place in the stars. That was, it's funny, even back then, I was concerned with remaining rooted in some fashion. It still seemed important. And then the big line, Lion makes a song that was, I swear I found the key to the universe. And the engine of an old parked car. That was important, because that's what I was trying to do. And I believed that, because I found so much in culture that was considered to be transient and trash, and just throwaway culture. And yet, I felt that I heard a world of pain and pleasure and beauty and darkness all coming out of those little records on the radio. And I don't want to find sort of my key to that. You know, it's there, it's even here, even in this town, you know. If I look hard, you know. Hid in the cloud of wrath of the crowd. That was something I did a lot. A lot of hiding, you know, in those days. And I just, all this other stuff that's swirling around in the songs, kind of, was I'm in here. And the cloud of wrath of the crowd. I guess I grew up feeling it was a hostile, pretty nasty world. And that I was broken, but that I was still mad. And that's what you feel in the song, I think. There's the insistence on a certain sort of magical fantasy almost, which can be, at a certain moment when you're young, can be pretty life-sustaining. That was pretty much how I ran through this song for me, you know. I'd been blinded by the light, but it could get real scary. You know? that's basically about sex, really. You know? That's basically man and woman falling in music. You know? It's a sexual imagery. Go back to that for a second. I'll see if I can demystify just a few of them. Mad Drummers Bummers, Mad Dog Winston Lopez, always in the fight. Indians in the Summer, that was my little league team, the Indians. The Dumps with the Mumps, the Adolescent Pumps, was way into his head, self-explanatory. The Bowler on my shoulder, feeling kind of older, 22, I don't know why, but I tripped the merry-go-round, that was my boardwalk line. Very unpleasing, sneezing, wheezing, colliding, crashed to the ground. Just general chaos, you know? All hot, half-shot, headed for the hot spot. Snapping his fingers, clapping his hands. That was me. Flesh pot, mascot, tied into a lover's knot with a whatnot in her hand. Self-explanatory. Young Scott with a slingshot, finally found a tender spot, throws his lover in the sand. Blinded by the light, cut loose like a deuce. This is the only thing that disturbed me in that Manfred Mann. There's a dethroned dictaphone hit in some funny moments where they expect at least just trying to be funny. So Nemo Chaperone standing in the corner all alone watching the young girls dance. Some fresh stone moonstones messing with this frozen zone. You know, I know, feeling romance. Self-explanatory. A silicone sister with her manager's Mr. Ooh, my introduction into the big time music business. Told me I got what it takes. So I'll turn you on, Sonny, to something strong to play that song with the funky break. Job description. Go to Cart, Mozart, check out another chart, see if it was safe to go outside. I don't know. We're on a dictionary. A little bit curly came by under curly one, asking if I needed a ride. Self-explanatory. Some hazard from Harvard was skunked on beer. Obviously, the premonitions of meeting Bob Coles. Trying hard since I'm new with a calling card. Yada, doing like jumped up, turned around, spit in the air, fell on the ground, which is the way back home. I wish that I knew.
Timmy Ryan likes going straight, night boys running around. Keeps going, believe it or not. Dan's brother, shooting star, riding a sack car, and I'm going to turn burning up and fucking A's in the rhyme dictionary. I said, well, this is a lot of course, a cookie jar, like the 60s, you know. There's a kidnapped handicap, obviously myself. Complaining that he caught the cop between mousetrap and the bar last night. Self-explanatory. I'm still got to move here, so I got here to be all right. Mama! Pulling that book into the life sights of the sun, but of course, that's where the fun is, so. This is a song covering the same territory I wrote when I was 50, so.